Hello, Shirley Adams here. I find a bunch of grapes not only tasty, but also very pretty. This is Series 10, Program 3. Stay with me for the grape escape. Everything furnishes inspiration for embellishment if you keep a receptive mind. I started thinking about how many ways we could actually sew a bunch of grapes, and here are some of the samples. You've heard the machine racing ahead without me, so let's go over to see what it has actually embroidered. I'm going to take it off the machine here and bring it up to show you. And what it has embroidered is a pretty little picture of grapes, and it's the same picture that you see on my shirt pocket. And as long as, now it wasn't quite finished, but as long as I don't take it out of the hoop, if I just leave it here, I could put it right back on the machine and attach the frame as it attaches to the back of the machine, and I could just continue the picture. So nothing is lost by taking it off as long as I don't take it out of the frame. So this is one way you could do it. If you have the capability of doing machine embroidery this way on your machine, you could do it that way. Well, another way we could do it, and I'm going to start on another machine now. This one is going to be elasticized. So I have down here on the counter some elastic grapes. And what I have used, of course, is elastic in the bobbin. And because of that, they all shrivel up then when you get through and when you release it from the hoop, which is how you would stitch it with the hoop. Now, where you would use something of this sort is, think about what garments it would work well on. A lightweight fabric, probably. But maybe in the yoke of a blouse or a dress, maybe on a full sleeve, you could have a couple of bunches of grapes and it wouldn't hurt that you had all that bunching up. So think about where you'd put it and plan this carefully. Now, the variables here are the weight of the fabric, for one thing, because it makes the grapes look completely different depending on how heavy or light it is. And also, what makes a big difference is how big those grapes are. Now, of the few samples that I have here that I'll show you, they're either quarter size or nickel or dime size. I've used one of those three to trace around to get the circles. And this one, as I stretch it out, it looks like it was probably, oh, nickel size perhaps on this one. And then, of course, it's all puckered up with the elastic thread on the back side. So there's one, not too really great. Also, be sure that you use for this a fabric that doesn't need to be pressed, because this one would need to be, so it's not really a good choice for it. Here's another one that might look nice. And what I have on this sample, this is washed rayon, and it does kind of nicely because it's a little bit weighty. It has a nice body to it. And these, I think, are also just small grapes. Yeah, dime size when I stretch those out, so they're also small ones. But they would do nicely. I can see those on a yoke or on a sleeve, or maybe even in the yoke of a skirt, perhaps put grapes all across the skirt part of it, the yoke part of it. This is the same t-shirt fabric, the interlock that I'm wearing, and that turned out kind of interestingly. And these, as I stretch them out, are, oh, about nickel size, I think, is what I have here. Down here, still on the table, are quarter size. So these are a little bit bigger, and I think I kind of like the way this one worked on this particular fabric. What I have down here in the hoop is just a piece of fabric that I've already drawn a few grapes on. I'll just draw one more. These were quarter size, so this is the idea. You simply put the coin down there, or a spool of thread also would work out well, just the end spool, and then go ahead and stitch around all these. Now, the way you want to thread your machine is put that monofilament thread perhaps in the top, or you could put the same color thread in the top as you're using the fabric here. I'm not using any tearaway here. I strictly have this one layer of fabric, so there's nothing else here. I'm keeping it lightweight, and this, of course, is not an automatic hoop the way the last one was that I embroidered on the other machine. This one I'm going to manipulate myself. What I've already done is set the feed dog down, because you don't want it in play. I've already put an embroidery foot on here so that it can go in any direction as you move it. And I just have this on straight stitch, and then I'm going to control how it moves. So if I put the foot down, decide, plan first of all where you're going to start. And that's up to you. Try it out on a practice thing, of course, first to see exactly how it's going to work out well. But as I do some stitching here, I'm going to go around this grape. And what it was telling me, by the way, all that noise it made was, have you done something wrong with the feed dog? There was a little message there for me, is why it made that noise, to remind me that the feed dog's out of play, which of course I knew. Okay, but you can see how this needs some practice. And did you see how I'm not quite hitting the line here? I'm a little off. It's a little bit deceptive when you have that embroidery foot because it's not right down on the fabric, it's above. So try to really concentrate, not on where you think the line is, but where the needle is actually going in the fabric. And I don't want to do any starting and stopping here. I'm going to stop for a second. And let's put it in the needle down position so it'll hold it. I'm going to stop just for a second here so I can cut off this thread that's going to keep catching and everything. But do watch where the needle goes down and hope to hit your lines better. Now, if I don't exactly hit these lines, it's nothing tragic because this is just the blue pencil. That means it's the water-soluble pencil. So it will come off. I can wash it off. If I use the purple pencil, the air-soluble, it would be just as easy. But you can see how you just retrace your lines if need be and keep going around those grapes. Oh, I went way wide on that one. And that's okay. You can't do anything too wrong with this. Go around here again. And about one more here. And I'll show you how this all puckers up. Now, it isn't going to do anything immediately. When it will do its thing, as far as shrinking up, is when you activate it with a little bit of steam. So I'm just going to cut this off, and I'm going to take it over to the ironing board and take the hoop off. And you can see it does a little bit of puckering here, but it really shrivels up very nicely when you get the steam near it. So as I put it down here and just give it a little shot of steam, you'll see it pucker up more. See, I'm not actually touching it. I'm just steaming it is all. And it does the job really well. So, okay, this is what it looks like. Now, as I said, this was lining fabric. It wasn't gorgeous fabric, but you get the idea. Kind of a fun way to make a grape. Okay, well, another type that you might do besides these would be up here. I'm going to do a little trapunto. And there are a couple of kinds of trapunto that you might do. One is genuine trapunto, and the other is mock trapunto. And depending on what kind of a project you're doing is how you decide which type you want to do. Now, I'm not even sure I'll stitch this one because I already have a lot of stitching here, and you get the idea. It's just straight stitching, so it's not a big deal at all. But with this bunch of grapes, I didn't want any color showing at all. So I used the same color thread, of course, as the fabric. And it's going to be kind of subtle, kind of pale. Here also, the monofilament thread would work nicely. But what I've done, first of all, is draw a picture on a piece of tissue paper is what this is, because it's going to tear away afterwards. And after I drew that picture, where I would put that is on the lining side, on the back of the fabric. In between, I would put nothing. If I wanted to do genuine trapunto, I would just put it down here and do the stitching through those three layers, the paper, the lining, and the fashion fabric. And I would just go ahead and do all that stitching. Then after I get finished, I'd rip off all the paper, and the picture is no more. You've ripped off all the paper. It's gone. And then notice what I've been doing here. Now, I've cut little holes in the back, and that's just taking scissors and clipping a little hole. And after you clip that little hole, and depending on how deep you need to go, just this one layer, you know, not very big, and then I'm going to stuff it with some fiber fill. Now, this is just quilt batting. It's kind of loose quilt batting, and you can either use the kind that's in the bag that's just bulk, or you can also use the sheets and just tear off a little piece of that. It doesn't matter. But as you get a little piece of that, these scissors might even make a good stuffer, just so that you can kind of push it in that hole and tuck it all in there. And once you get it started, then it tucks pretty easily. It's just getting it started. You might even need to have a little pair of tweezers here to hold up that one layer to get it going. But anyway, it's just a matter of pushing it all in there. Come on, I can't even get it started. But once it's started, then it's very easy. Honest, it really is to tuck in. So you just do that for each little shape that you're going to fill. I've already got some of the leaf done. Here's the stem and some little curly cues coming from it. And what I would use this on probably, because it's pretty firm now, and see how it lumps all around it. It doesn't stay completely flat as you would like it to be, perhaps in a garment. So I might use this on a pillow. By the time there would be a pillow under it, stuffing it more firmly, then it would look a lot better. So this is genuine trapunto. A pillow would do nicely. If I would do this for a garment, though, I have one up here on the rack that I'd like to show you. And what I have done with this garment is to use just a mock trapunto instead of stuffing it from the back side. And I have some on the back of them here too. Now, what I did for this is to use the same layers just reach over here to get them. I still want the lining, I still want the fashion fabric, but I'm going to put this right at the outset in between the two layers, so that when it's in between the two layers and then I put the paper on top and pin it all in place and I can stitch around, and it gives that nice little puffy effect without having it quite as bulky or quite as firm as it was with the stuffed kind. So anyway, this is another type, and this was very easy to do. Now of course you have to have a lining. What I've done in here for the lining is, I'll just release the skirt there and show you. I didn't want to line this whole jacket, so I only have a partial lining in here so that it does just furnish the backing that it needs before I have the stuffing between the two layers. So trapunto, another way that you might do this. Now another one down here that's kind of fun is, think about making a little girl's dress, for instance, and you put a big deep hem in perhaps a pinafore, and in that big deep hem, wouldn't it be kind of fun to have some sort of a design? So what I have here, of course, is a bunch of grapes in between these two. Now my thinking at first was, if I would first glue it in place, either with a glue stick or with a little fusible release sheet, if I would first do that and pull off the paper and put it between there and actually fuse it in place, that it might be easier. Well, you can see it doesn't look nice. You can see on the back side the fusing, and I want both sides to look really nice. So I decided, no, let's don't do it that way. Let's instead just take a scrap of fabric and cut out all our grapes. I have one going down here. And what I would do with these grapes then is just between the layers, just arrange them the way I want. And I found that it really doesn't even need to be glued down. If I just tuck grapes in wherever they want to be or wherever they would look right. And you aren't committed to anything as long as you aren't gluing or fusing this. You just tuck them in as seems appropriate. And when you get them right in place nicely, then you put it in a hoop. And you won't need any tearaway stabilizer or any type in here. Just with a hoop, that'll suffice. And get it all nice and tightly tucked in place. And once that's in, then it's just the same type of stitching that I already did with the elastic, except this time you take out the elastic and just put regular thread in the bobbin, or bobbin thread that you could use continuously for all sorts of sewing. The bobbin thread is usually a real lightweight type of thread, and white, because you'll never see it. The thread gets pulled up on top by the top thread, so you'll never see this bobbin thread. It'll work out just very nicely. Let me go ahead and pull that bobbin thread up. And I'm not actually going to stitch this, because obviously you just manipulate it the same way as I did with the elastic thread. Just put the hoop in here and move it around and stitch the outline. And as long as you're doing that with the monofilament thread, it really doesn't even show when you're finished. And that would be very pretty in some sort of a double layer, whether it's a little girl's pinafore or an apron for Aunt Susie for Christmas or whatever it is that you're doing. While I have this thread and this the monofilament as well as the embroidery thread down below, I'm going to do another one here. And this one is just really fun. Now this is the type stitching that you say, family, go fix your own dinner. I'm busy, I'm sewing, don't interrupt me, because this is really fun and this is really addictive. Once you start it, it's very hard to stop. Now what this is I'll take the embroidery foot off, and what I want on here instead is this foot that's called a miracle stitcher is what it is. It's kind of similar to an embroidery foot, but a little bit different. I'll put it on. Let me show it to you before I put it on. It has this little finger on top, and that finger rests on top of the needle, and it makes everything go up and down. And there's a spring that helps that happen. So I'll put this in, and we'll see what comes of it. Okay, not only do I want to have this foot on in place here, okay, but also I'm going to put something on the needle screw that's back here. And it's this little cup. There are a couple little cups and a little cones there. I'm going to clip this on the needle screw, and then I'm going to lift the top here because I want to put another spool pin here. So I'll put that at the top here. And the reason I'm using this second spool pin is because I'm going to stitch all this yarn on. This is what it's going to look like. I'll just add a few more grapes to this. And what those grapes are, they're yarn. They're mohair yarn like this, so it's kind of variegated. And it's very pretty, and this is just a fun thing to do. Now I also need for this, I'm just pulling some yarn out here because you don't want it to pull tight. So I'm sitting it on my lap and having it loose by having extra yarn. And I'm going to just loop that yarn over the needle or the spool pin that I have there. And then I'm going to use this little cup that I clipped on here to put the yarn in. And there's a slit on the side of it, so the yarn will just pull in place here. And then I'm going to put this yarn through a slit that's in the foot. As I said, similar to an embroidery foot, but not quite. But there is a slit in here, and I want to get through that slit both the monofilament thread that's on the top, as well as the yarn. And I do have some stabilizer under here. Now I'm working with a knit. This is the same knit that I'm wearing. And when you work with a knit, it's a good idea to have something kind of sticking to it more firmly. So what I have on here is a stabilizer that has a temporary fusible on the back of it. It's a peel-off thing. And actually you can use it again and again if you want to. The parts that you rip off, you could really use again. So what I'm going to do with this is put it under. And when I start stitching, I want to have this on zigzag, so I better push the zigzag button. And I'm going to check out my stitch width because I want it narrower. This is on 5 point, and I want it on 1.5. So I've put it down narrow, and now I'm just going to make a grape right here. So let's get the foot down, that would help, and let's see what happens. Now what you want to do usually is stitch kind of fast, but move your project slowly. And so I'm stitching a little faster and I'm moving the project. And you can see how easy this is. Now, if you want to, you can go ahead and draw lines. Or if you don't want to draw lines, just do it freehand. And after I finish this one grape and get it plenty round, I'll just move to another area. And let me stop a minute with the needle down so it holds it in place. And I'm just going to cut off what I don't want here so that it won't get stitched in with it. And pull out a little more yarn so it won't pull tight, because then it doesn't do as pretty a job if the yarn pulls tight, so you want it to stay loose. But anyway, you can see how easy this is to manipulate. You could also put it in a hoop if you want to, but it doesn't need to be. It works so easily just this way. And make it as big or as yarny as you want. Maybe keep it on until another color starts to appear. And put another grape out here. But anyway, you can see this is fun to do. And this is the one that I just love to build pictures with. And I just hate to stop and do anything else. But anyway, this is miracle stitching, and it's a lot of fun. So let me take it out and show you what it looks like. I'll just cut off the extra here and put it down so that you can see. So here we have, let me get the bottom thread off so it'll move. There we have that one. And I kind of like this variegated yarn. It works nicely. Okay, then we have a couple of others here that aren't going to involve the machine. They are instead going to be done on the ironing board mainly. So one of these that I have is simply an applique. Now this, to make it easy, I was using some suede on it. And to use the suede, what I have done is just cut out, I've drawn my circles on the back. You can see that it has some fusible release sheet on it that's ironed in place. So I'd cut out my circles, and again, quarters, spools of thread, whatever makes the right size circle for you. And after I get that all cut out, here I have one cut out. I'm going to peel off the backing, because of course we have this paper backing on any of the fusible release sheets. And there are a few brands of these on the market. Some brands are sturdier than others. And if you don't want to stitch this, if you just want to do the applique with the iron and quit at that, then it's a good idea to use one of the heavy duty ones that won't actually need to be stitched around. So that's what I have on right now, a heavy duty one. And as I put that on place, you naturally don't want to put your iron down on suedes and leathers. You want to use a press cloth always. So I'm going to open up this press cloth and put it down. And once you have it in place, the nice thing about this is you can build your picture completely before you commit yourself to anything by actually pressing it. Rearrange the grapes until you like what you have, and then just put it in place and go ahead with the steam iron and fuse it in place. And it doesn't take very long, just a little bit of fusing. While I have this press cloth on, it doesn't matter if I slightly rotate the iron. Nothing will move. And once I decide that, okay, that's probably enough, then you can just pick it up and see what has happened. And pick up your press cloth carefully, because if you find that it isn't completely fused, then this one is, it's tight. But if it isn't, you can put it down and keep working on it some more. You can always add grapes. They don't all have to be done at the same time. So here's one way of appliquing. If you'll look over at the other side of the table here, where the camera is going to take you, let's see some other type applique. Now, these are really some pretty things, and I borrowed them. They aren't mine. It wasn't my idea, but I'd like to show you what these look like, because I think they're just really neat. What I have here is a couple of bags. Here is an eyeglass holder, and it works for two pair of glasses, sunglasses as well as your reading glasses. Put them both in here. So this is one. She's done a lot of grapes. This is Ann Wall, and she makes patterns for these, plus many other different designs, and she lives down in Texas. And here's one, a little Kleenex holder, because, as I said, they're fun to do, so you might want to do it several times. A belt here that's adjustable. There's Velcro on the back side of it. And a couple of different bags here. Now, this is reverse applique from what I showed you a minute ago, because all these little places are cut out, and the backing shows through. So you choose the color backing. You can see that Anne has this done now in greens and purples over here. Down on this one and the other small accessory, she has it done in black as the background color. But let's see how she does that. First of all, you trace the design on a piece of any of the fusible release sheets would be good. And you possibly want to stitch, there again, whether you stitch it or not depends on how much stitching you want to do. Now, perhaps you noticed Anne had a lot of stitching there. And so if you don't want to do all that, use one of the heavy duty fusibles so that you don't have to. But anyway, you'd press that down to the back side. And after you get it pressed, and I'll just go ahead and press this, after you get it pressed to the back side, then you're going to do a lot of cutout work. And this is going to have to be either with a little knife, a sharp little knife. And what I have here is one of Anne's patterns, and you can see the vest there. Oh, let me show you that vest. Here it is on the rack. I'll bring it down where you can see it better. Here's the same vest and the same back that you're seeing. Okay, well, here's the pattern. And it's just a matter of tracing the design that's on that pattern. So it looks like this. You just trace it, and then you cut out everything you don't want so the backing will show through. And I'd put it on a cutting mat, of course, to do this job. And you can use for that either leave the release sheet on it. Of course, you need to have the design there. And you can use this either for this, either one of these little knives, and I'll just cut the stem here slightly. And you have to do a double cut for the stem so that it actually comes out. Did I cut it through? No, I didn't. I was afraid to apply too much pressure. I'd need a little more pressure to actually cut it through. Or you could also use just some little sharp scissors so that you can get through this and cut it very well. I'll first make a cut in this grape and then cut around the outside. Now this, as you can see, would be a good job when there's that movie on TV that you want to watch, because it's going to take you a while to do all this cutout work. And Anne has beautifully stitched around every one of her projects. So that means she used one of the lightweight fusible release sheets and she did the stitching. If you don't care to do that, then use the heavy duty and you can just fuse it down in place on top whatever color you're using and it'll show through. So there's another way to do grapes. Now I haven't begun to exhaust all the means because I'm sure you can think of others. One other that I have here is a little embroidery. Now this is a hand-woven fabric, and I tried to do these grapes, first of all, up here. These were my first two grapes. And you can see they aren't quite circles. They don't look marvelous. And the reason they aren't is because this fabric is so loosely, well, look at my finger down here. You can see my finger really pushing through because this is very, very loosely woven fabric. And because of that, it doesn't work well to embroider in it. So think about what your backing is. What I found does work well for the rest of these grapes that I've done is to fuse a backing on. I have one of the lightweight fusible interfacings here, a knit one, and just lightweight, just to stabilize it and block the big holes there between the yarns and the fabric. And as I do this embroidery, now this is a crewel needle that I have here, and that means there's a blunt point and there's a great big eye. And that big eye means you can thread any kind of yarn through it easily. So with this needle, it's very easy to embroider it. Now the grapes that I have down here are some more of that fusible release sheet, whatever it is that you use. And this can be a lightweight, it doesn't matter what kind you use. But what I've done is cut out a lot of grapes, put them down in place, then put the press cloth over this and fuse it in place. Now the reason I wanted to do this is because I decided this isn't going to wear very well with all those loose yarns coming across the whole distance of the grape here, as you can see. This isn't too good an idea to have them all loose. So I thought if I put all these down first with the fusible, then what I can do is peel this off before I start embroidering. You can still faintly see the fusible still down there. I'll just go ahead and embroider, and what this is, get some yarn out of there. What this is, you start it on the back side, and as you come up, you just keep going across, and you just stitch across, and maybe it'd be a good idea to stitch them all the same direction. I've done all these grapes in different directions, but this goes fast, and it's a fun project to do also. So you can see, not too difficult. Everybody can do this. You will need a crewel needle for it because it just does the job so much more easily. Once we have this all done, then of course you'd press it and all these yarns would no longer float over the top and be endangered. They would fuse to the fabric. Well, did you have a little fun doing grapes? If you want to do something really quick and easy, how about just a bunch of purple buttons here? Arrange those in grape shape. And it's another way to do grapes. Well, for those of you, speaking of grapes, for those of you who are concerned about the years going by, I recently saw a pretty little porcelain box which was inscribed, "Age doesn't matter unless you are wine." I kind of like the sentiment. Well, next time we're going to use a little bit of Trapunto in a decoratively shaped waistband. So come along to see how that can be done.